Well, good morning, everybody. I think I must begin by thanking Dr. Vijay Agarwal, Dr. Alex Thomas, for giving me this opportunity to come and address this August gathering regarding the impact of accreditation, the Indian perspective. You have heard the foreign perspective. Now it's our chance to take over. Before that, I also wish to thank the leader of quality who got me here, Dr. Giridhar Gyani, and today I stand before you because of him. I am, along with him, one of the founder members of NABH. Also, I thank NABH for giving me access to certain data and information which I am going to use today. Having said that, a disclaimer. No conflicts of interest. Views of author are based on subjective and objective analysis. Contents are permitted to be shared amongst each other. And I'm not claiming any copyrights or credits for myself. Okay, so you can copy this and use it wherever, whenever you feel like. I strongly believe to understand an impact, you must know what was before that event happened. So before accreditation came into this country, we must know the story or the history of the past. And the past is prior to 2005. What was quality, patient safety, and accreditation in this country? They were mainly confined to textbooks. It was taught as a subject for training of residents of hospital administration. And it was probably a short note in the examinations. And accreditation, if you viva voce, you could spell it, it was taken as you know the subject. But healthcare began recognizing quality and its importance because of certain legal issues that started coming up. Primary amongst them was the Consumer Protection Act of 1986, which made people to realize that you need to document what you are carrying. You need to defend yourself. So for them, the quality became how to defend myself in case of an adverse event for which I am going to be held liable. Most indicators were mortality related. Some were morbidity related, but nobody talked about risk adjustments. And hospital administrators were particularly fond of utilization-based statistics. Bed utilization, bed occupancy, OT utilization, ICU utilization, because that meant money to some people, and that also meant turnover for the other people. Every healthcare professional thought that he knows everything. He is expert in CPR. The healthcare-associated infections I can combat. I know my growth charts. I know the immunization status. I know everything. Antibiotics usage was the domain of the physician and the surgeon. They wished to use the antibiotics they liked. I don't know where things have changed now. But they used what they wanted. Microbiologist was an adjunct. There was focus on EBM, but E represented experience-based medicine. I am 30 years experience, which could also mean I am carrying forward 1 year experience for the next 30 years. Patient rights, if any, were the primary domain of human rights activists. And of course, documentation of care, as I said earlier, was mainly to represent and prevent yourself from adverse events of a legal consequence. Clinical protocols were assumed to be known by the physicians. They were all there in their head. They did not require monitoring because they knew the best. Everybody was happy. Healthcare continued. Maternal mortality reduced. Infant mortality reduced. Polio got eradicated. Guinea worm got eradicated. Smallpox got eradicated. Life expectancy increased. There were no draconian standards to be followed. And those who actually ventured into this domain were thought to be crazy. And if mistakes occurred, this was the response. Shh, gabbar aa jayega. Gabbar is Consumer Protection Act. So brush it under the carpet. So what changed in 2005? What happened? Apollo Indraprastha got accredited by Joint Commission International. Everybody wondered why. What was the need in this country? And media felt it was a colossal waste of resources. You are spending in those days lakhs and crores to achieve JCI accreditation with which you could have actually taken care of a village. What is the necessity of this accreditation? This is what media asked these questions. And there were six crazy men dealing with various aspects of healthcare. They were brought together. They were the six crazy men. You find one of them, me also, somewhere. And they were all related to health field. But they were brought together under the leadership of a still crazier man who happens to be sitting here, who was not actually working in the health field at all. He was an engineer by profession, Secretary General Quality Council of India. And he brought together this team to bring forth some accreditation standards in this country. So NABH was born. It was conceived in 2005. It finally delivered in 2006. You do require gestation period for delivery. It gave the first set of accreditation standards in this country. But very few gave it a chance. Friends became foes. What is this? We are already accountable to Consumer Protection Act. Now you are making us accountable to some accreditation. Professionals walked out of the sensitization program held in this very city in the year 2006. They just walked out. When we distributed the standards free of cost, we gave them lunch free of cost, but they walked out. What is this? You are trying to implement standards in this country where quantity overrules quality. So many patients I get to see in my clinic. How do you think I'm going to document? Are you going to give me this many nurses? Are you asking me to enter protocols and monitor them? This concept was doomed to fail. There were no resources available. This country could not provide resources. What about government hospitals? Can they ever come into the ambit of accreditation? Or is it a tool for controlling corporate hospitals? Government has thought of a new tool, how to keep corporate hospitals in check. But NABH continued its relentless journey. It never saw the obstacles. It looked at what impact it is going to make in the future. NABH standards got ISQA accreditation. Healthcare professionals started noticing the small changes. The care became uniform. Consistency in care arose. Some processes would take place automatically. SGO started coming forward. Government realized and started paying higher incentives to those hospitals and healthcare organizations which had become accredited. So what is the present? There are 600 healthcare organizations and 218 small healthcare organizations which have been accredited as on date. 828 healthcare and 1,318 small healthcare organizations are entry level certified. 200 healthcare organizations and 218 small healthcare organizations have applied for accreditation. The applications are pending with NABH. And around same amount, 800 and 3,000 healthcare organizations are awaiting certification for entry level. For those who are interested in primary healthcare, there are more than 100 primary health centers which have been certified by the NABH, and mainly in the region of Maharashtra and Gujarat, and some in Tamil Nadu. Patient safety, quality in healthcare, and accreditation-based conferences are being held at regular intervals. First conference, second conference, third patient safety conference, international patient safety conference, when nobody used to talk about patient safety prior to the accreditation standards. Patient safety goals came to be known through the accreditation standards. They have become the buzzword of healthcare environment. More and more professionals are now keen to take training. NABH is unable to provide that training because the scope of activity is increased. Knowledge about NABH, JCIA, Australian standards, Canadian standards are becoming one of the prerequisites for employment for several healthcare professionals. Training in various aspects of healthcare quality is being encouraged and conducted across healthcare organizations, irrespective of their size, complexity, and ownership. And government has introduced its own ISQA accredited standards to be followed in public healthcare organizations. Adverse events and errors are being reported. Data for several performance-related indicators being collected and monitored. Documentation is being given importance. Quality of healthcare is being measured or being attempted to be measured objectively. And organizations like CAHO and AHPI have come forward to do hand-holding for taking this quality movement forward. If NABH accreditation standards had not come in this country, CAHO would not have been born. AHPI would not have been there. What an impact. Today, we appreciate these organizations for promoting quality in this country and taking that responsibility away from the Board of Quality Promotion from QCI because of these accreditation standards. So it has made an impact. But you know, in brief, I can say that India woke up to the concept of quality, patient safety, and accreditation because of the accreditation standards. But you will tell me this is theory. You will tell me this is your perception. You are one of the founder members. You have to support it. What is the objective evidence? Has it got any impact? Has it actually made an impact? So let us see some isolated studies published in certain Indian journals. Indian Journal of Clinical Anesthesia. After implementation of NABH standards, UTI reduced to 50% within 6 months of NABH implementation. The central line associated bloodstream inspections reduced to zero for 400 central line days. Incidence of ventilator associated pneumonias and surgical site infection brought to zero for 80 ventilator days and 200 operations performed. One study. Another study in Asian Journal of Transfusion Science. Monitoring and implementation of core blood transfusion service indicators of NABH resulted in reduced wastage of blood and blood components, reduced average turnaround time for issue of blood and blood products, and reduced number of adverse transfusion reactions. This was the first hospital which was accredited by JCI, Apollo Indraprastha. Their findings after 1 year of implementation of JCI standards in India related said improve patient safety by improving hand hygiene and patient processes, reduce medication errors by 78%, increase revenues by 20%, and improved employee safety. At NABH, under the leadership of Dr. Gyani, I carried out a study in India covering about 25 hospitals, the first ever study having so many hospitals. The study incorporated certain hospitals. There were 5 corporate hospitals, there were 11 private hospitals, there were 6 government and public sector and 3 trust hospitals, out of which 16 were accredited, 1 had not applied for accreditation, but had incorporated certain quality systems in their designs, and 8 had applied for accreditation. We tested these components of our standards, that is the AAC, COP, medication management, patient rights, healthcare association infection, biomedical waste management, and facility management and CQI. On these 4 parameters, about awareness of the standards, about their implementation, about their monitoring, and the overall impact. And we did conduct a statistical analysis where the difference in median and p-value using the Kruskal-Wallis test demonstrated that the performance in all parameters in almost all the components improved in a highly statistically significant manner in all the hospitals after accreditation or after incorporation of quality management systems. Government and public sector hospitals showed greater degree of improvement because the initial levels were much lower. These are some of the areas which showed most improvement. Awareness about patient rights, the implementation showed a lot of improvement, but level of monitoring was still left to be desired, but overall impact was there. Similarly, if you see, most of the areas like HIC manual, antibiotic policy, use of standard precautions, biomedical waste management, all had a tremendous improvement after implementation of the standards. Same thing, key clinical indicators were being monitored, at least where people were aware. Implementation was not to that extent, but level of monitoring showed some gray areas of plus and minus. Key managerial indicators actually took off. Because they were already in operation, they got more strengthened and augmented. The central events were being identified, recognized, and monitored. Equipment calibration was done for 100% of the equipments. People never understood there's a difference between calibration and maintenance. This difference also came to light. The CPR, of course, practices improved by leaps and bounds. Vulnerable patient care, people became aware, but implementation, monitoring, and overall impact was plus minus. Medical audit improved tremendously. Fire safety, everything improved, but the implementation level remained plus and minus because over a period of time, people became casual. Checklists got introduced in almost all the areas. Again, pain management, end-of-life care, which are non-existent in a healthcare delivery system, they became aware and they started being implemented. Discharge summaries, biggest improvement. When, where, and how to improve patient care. See some indicators. Only about 12 hospitals were actually practicing indicators before the accreditation was in standards were implemented. And you see, patient satisfaction improved. The average length of stay came down. The medication error reporting became much higher. The net mortality rate before and after accreditation came down. So, you see, did accreditation standards implementation not make an impact? I think both subjectively and objectively, we can arrive at that conclusion. These are some of the things which NABH gave me. There were about 200 hospitals whose data was taken. That at that time, all these indicators which we are saying, at the time of pre-assessment, only 30% of the hospitals, like incidence of medication errors, only 30% of the hospitals were actually capturing medication errors. But by the time they went for the next renewal assessment, 100% of the hospitals at least capturing the data. So you see, all these things, when you start from pre-assessment to review renewal assessment for the next assessment, there has been a tremendous increase in terms of implementation. So our major conclusion is that accreditation has positively impacted quality outcomes and patient safety. But, there is always a but. We have challenges which are to be overcome. We have a lot of challenges. One is, we do need now total quality-oriented leadership. We have to ensure that these quality movements, patient safety movements now go to far off areas, go to the areas where they matter. Because we have got 50,000 hospitals, only 5,000 are in the system. What about the rest 45,000? We have to access to them. Once we access to them, then patient care will be accessible to the patients. We have to focus on training and retraining, learning and sharing of information amongst each other, and dissemination. Trained manpower has become a challenge. Establishing a safety culture is now the need of the hour. Sustaining quality and accreditation over longer periods and not restricting those 5 days, wo 5 din, we should not restrict ourselves to those 5 days and reaching out to the unreachable. Bringing in client engagement. I know when you put a ring, it is an engagement ring. And always engagement ring is followed by suffering. But we have to have that suffering. Because if we don't suffer, events will not occur. We must introduce patient safety and quality in medical, nursing and paramedical training curriculum. Start from the baseline and make quality a way of life. We have a long way to go. At least miles to go before I sleep and miles to go before we sleep. So we have challenges, but I know we have the solutions. We can improve quality in healthcare and reduce patient harm because this is everyone's business. It's not only the accreditation authority's business. There is much to be learned and shared. Thank you very much. Jai Hind. The show has to go on.